Priyar with CEA Dr. K.M. Subramanian for his comments, his views and his reactions to his own economic survey 2020 and the union budget. It has been a historic budget in many ways, so is the economic survey. Let's see what the CEA has his views. We are meeting him after the budget.
Wealth and wealth creation itself, started to be regarded as something that actually is not good, is evil. And that's why I think, it was important for us to actually go and dig deep into what is really, what is in our DNA in some sense. And I think what is amply clear using both the ancient wisdom and current economic evidence, contemporary evidence, it is very clear that wealth creation, especially the ethical wealth, ethical wealth creation benefits everybody. So the main objective of the economic survey was whatever residual, thinking we have, basically saying that socialistic policies or closed, sectors will basically generate prosperity for us. We wanted to try and actually, enlighten, those parts of the thinking as well, and bring about and say what is really the case. The stock market is one measure of basically wealth, not the only measure, but one measure. But what is crucial, and we've shown clearly, is that when economic freedom is enabled through, for instance, the liberalization as it happened, look at the composition of the Sensex. In 1986, you had a few sectors, for instance, the materials, basically, and some consumer goods sectors. They were the ones that accounted for the bulk of the Sensex, the market value in the Sensex. But today, sectors, for instance, financial services, information technology, telecom, these are many sectors which were not even existent at that time, which have come in, which basically shows that in a market economy, creative destruction happens. And in fact, if you, this idea of creative destruction is also something that is very ancient in our thinking. When we think about the Trinity, the role of Shiva is always thought as one of creative destruction.
Let's come to some of the most key and the most controversial sides of this year's budget. But economic survey kind of made a preparatory ground for that, for people to accept it. That's, I'm talking about the fiscal deficit. In just day before, you almost made fiscal deficit slippages acceptable to everyone, given that we have to focus on growth. I mean, when the budget it was announced that the escape clause has been used, it didn't appear out of the blue. So for the first time, it is also kind of a first time that a budget focused on hardcore economic issues. It never used to be like this, because I myself covered quite a few. So do you think we are coming to a stage when fiscal deficit is becoming more or less irrelevant?
No, I would not say fiscal deficit is not relevant.
For countries and developing countries like India?
No, fiscal deficit is relevant. And I think, and as I have actually mentioned elsewhere as well, macroeconomic stability is something that it's non-negotiable. If we go and look at the episode that happened, around 2009, after the financial crisis, we, basically really let the fiscal deficit balloon up significantly. And what we got was, after a couple of years, the taper tantrum in 2013, and India became part of the Fragile Five. So it is really important to, to basically get this delicate balance between fiscal prudence and, impetus to growth right. What the economic survey, what was said was, in this delicate balance between fiscal prudence and, and spurt for growth, we need to lean on growth. Leaning on growth and, putting all your weight on growth are two different expressions. So we basically chose our words carefully and said we need to lean on growth. And what the budget therefore has done is taken the 50 basis points of 0.5% escape clause within the ambit of the FRBM Act. And one of the things that I have always believed is, if you don't learn from history, you're condemned to repeat it. And we did not want to actually, we wanted to learn from the history, you know, the episodes that what led up to the taper tantrum, didn't want to repeat it. And that is why we actually have kept it within the ambit of the FRBM Act. Yet there is actually an important push for, you know, for growth through the rural sector. The 16-point program, you know, that the FM emphasized on. And this itself was driven by the fact that the economic survey showed that rural inflation has been stagnant while urban inflation has risen. You know, part of which is because rural incomes themselves are quite, you know, have not risen as much. And therefore, there was a need for focusing on enhancing rural income.
Survey has, I'll come back to a survey a bit because it was high point on another issue, that is subsidy. It's for probably again for the first time a survey has taken a very hard note towards subsidy. Why is it being paid even after so many years? Why can't this just be phased away? And the budget seems to have taken a quite good year to it. And there are indications and signs of subsidies being and the exemptions being taken away. So do you think, coming to subsidy, this is high time we should think of a gradual phase out of food subsidies and those subsidies. Fuel subsidy is almost on its way out, but
yes.
Food subsidy is still quite significant in the total subsidy bill, and it is pushing up the revenue expenditure.
So I think, you know, last several years there has been a movement towards reducing some of these subsidies. You mentioned about the fuel subsidies. I think, you know, to the extent that the subsidies are efficient, for instance PM Kisan, which is basically an input, you know, you're giving it for input costs. And there is also research that shows that when you take care of basically input costs and when you take care of the risks that a farmer faces, it basically crowds in investment on the part of the farmer. So it actually has a good economic rationale to it. When a subsidy does not reach, let's say, you know, the intended beneficiary, you know, we all remember a former prime minister mentioning that, you know, of 100 rupees, only 15 rupees actually reaches, or of 1 rupee, only 15 paisa reaches actually the. So if the subsidy is first, if it is, you know, efficient, and second, if it actually reaches the intended beneficiary, it makes economic sense. But, you know, in cases where, you know, one or both of those are not, objectives are not achieved, then it is inefficient. And it is in that context that the government over the last several years has been trying to, one, use direct benefit transfers so that the subsidy clearly goes directly in the hands of the beneficiary, and also has been, you know, trying to roll back some of those subsidies which are you know, inefficient. So this is something which actually there is already a buy-in in the government.
Focusing a little bit on another target, which is questioned at many quarters, as you might have guessed by now, that is the disinvestment target. Half of next fiscal's target was this year, which has now been lowered to almost half of that is 65,000 crore. What are we looking at? Are we looking at an imaginary situation? LIC listing, 90,000 crore coming from disinvestment from banks, stake dilution.
That includes LIC.
That includes LIC.
Mm-hmm.
Are these all really feasible in 1 year?
Absolutely.
And Air India and BPCL disinvestment, because let me remind you, sir, these disinvestments are not CPSE to CPSE disinvestment like HPCL and ONGC. These are market related foreign domestic players who would exclusively look at their benefits and value
of
taking. So, and it is the stake sales, IPOs are all market issues.
Of course. So
nothing is in our hands. So how we are so sure of achieving doubling it to 2.1 lakh crore and the fiscal deficit premises is built around this?
First of all, many of the deals on which track action has been going on this year itself. For instance,
yes.
Take Air India and BPCL. There has, you know, there has been a lot of work that has already happened, and it's just that those could not be closed by March this year, and that is why they actually will get closed in the coming year. So, you know, more than half of this target will get met by just these, you know, what is basically a spillover from this year to the next year.
So that is Concor, Air India and BPCL.
Yes, absolutely. We should, you know, more than half should get taken care of there itself. So that leaves you with the, you know, with about 90,000 crores. I'll use my own experience of having sat on some boards and board of a bank which went through an IPO when I was on the board. And from the, you know, from basically deciding to do an IPO to actually getting the IPO done, it was done in the space of a few months. So it is something that is actually, it is doable. Yes, there is, you know, I'm not denying that there are legislative amendments that are required here in the case of LIC in particular. But I think this is something that is doable. It's not, remember, this is not actually a, in the case of LIC, it is only a listing of, you know, and of about, I would think that about 6 to 7%, you know, would be enough to actually get, you know, this entire 90,000 crores. 6 to 7% would be enough. I've done some back of the envelope calculations based on which, you know, just selling 6 to 7% will be enough to actually, you know, mop up 90,000 crores.
Thank you so much, Mr. Subramanian, for spending so much well inside and well scripted thoughts with IAS. Thank you so much.